silahkan.
Yeah.
That is your pointer.
Pointer.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, thank you very much everyone for joining this afternoon session, and I'm sorry that I wasn't been able to join all of you for the morning sessions, and it's truly my great pleasure to be here with all of you in this very important meeting. Some of you are familiar faces to me, but some are not, but so please feel free after this to come to me and introduce yourself to me, and also I'm very open to any questions, any discussions if that would help. I have to say that I really enjoy the title of the theme of this meeting, because it feels like it really encourages us to think how innovative we can to try to move the testing and the treatment forward in this country and also in our region. So my task first is to bring to you key messages from the AIDS 2018 meeting in Amsterdam in July this year. And it's my pleasure to represent the International AIDS Society for this task. I try to gather all the key information which is related to the main theme for today's meeting, testing and treatment, from the AIDS 2018 to you here. So my talk, which may be very quick because we only have like 30 minutes for the presentation and then another 30 minutes for question and answer, will involve the innovative ways that many countries presented at AIDS 2018 on how they can do the testing and how they can initiate ART in a rapid way or in a same day way, and how that in that implementation has led to us starting to see some trends in the decline of HIV infections in many settings. And then I will talk a little bit about the sustainability of HIV programs, because I think that is the most important part for countries in our region on how we are transitioning ourselves from donor-funded programs into domestic-funded program. And then lastly, I will touch a bit on PrEP, service delivery model, so not like really the basic science thing about PrEP, but how to deliver PrEP, how to set up PrEP service delivery models in the region and also elsewhere. So let me start by showing some data from many countries, showing the trends in the declines in HIV infection. And the first slide showed to you an example from many countries in Africa, which show that the reduction in new HIV cases actually correlates very nicely with the increase in viral suppression in the community. And also in Melbourne and in San Francisco, we can also see a dramatic reduction in the number of new HIV cases, which is very much related to how you can shorten the time from HIV testing, HIV diagnosis, then to the start of ART, and then to viral suppression. So the shorter time you can do for each of these steps will lead you to seeing the more reduction in new HIV cases. And then the partner to study is another important study, has been cited many times after its 2018 meetings, because it's one of the important study to support the concept of that treatment is prevention, right? We have learned from almost a decade now from the HPTN 052 study that treatment is prevention, but maybe only for heterosexual populations, but from the opposite attract study presented last year and this partner 2 study presented this year, we can be very sure that treatment is prevention for men have sex with men as well. And in this partner 2 study, among 1,600 couple years of follow-up of almost 1,000 gay menstrual discordant couples, and with 77,000 condomless sex acts, when viral load is undetectable, we have not seen any linked transmission. So this confirms that treatment is prevention and undetectable equals untransmittable. I believe you may have heard this quote, "you equals you," many times already in this meeting. But in many countries, we now started to use this "you equals you" campaign, not only to bring people to the feeling that we should do more HIV testing, we should treat more people to get them virally suppressed, but also "you equals you" campaign has been used very effectively in terms of reducing stigma for people living with HIV, both self-stigma and stigma in the community, to those who already know their status, already have been on ART and already have viral load suppression. And then you may have heard I'm talking about heterosexual populations, key populations, many times, and I think that is very relevant to the situation in Indonesia, where you are seeing a growing proportions of new HIV infections coming from key populations, and here it's mainly men women and male sex workers. So the next part of my talk will be the implementation methods or innovative ways of implementation, which do not only target heterosexual population, but also key populations as well. So let me start with the testing part here. There are two very nice studies presented at ES 2018 telling the audiences about how we can effectively reach populations online and then bring them offline for HIV testing. The Test MNL campaign in the Philippines nicely demonstrated that by having this online campaign coupled with offline events, the HIV testing increased more than 60% after the campaign at the MSM Friendly Clinic in Manila. And in Vietnam, the Facebook community called the Rainbow Village have nicely used the trained online influencers who can talk about HIV and HIV testing, and plus the online booking for HIV testing system, so online HIV testing booking system called the iReserve system, to successfully link people 77% from online reaching to actual testing with a very high HIV positive yield of around 12%. And they have also done a very impressive work linking 100% of those tested positive to ART. So these two online campaigns have been demonstrated that using online platform, you can reach people who have high risk of HIV and can successfully link them to actual testing. Still with the online platforms, but then to add HIV self-testing into the online platform. Two studies here in Thailand and in China show how you can integrate HIV self-testing into the online platform. The one in Thailand used the online supervision for HIV self-testing with MSM and transgender women. And we have seen that almost half of those who choose by themselves to get this online support for HIV self-testing have never been tested before. And the HIV testing yield is quite high at 16%, although the rate of linkage to care, to confirmation and to care, has not been very high. It's just around 50%, which is lower than the routine linkage to care in a conventional HIV testing setting. Then in China, the online platform providing internet-based HIV self-testing requests and support has demonstrated that they can reach those who half of them never been tested, and then again high HIV positive yield at 14%. But here in China, 72% were successfully linked to confirmation and to treatment. But then outside of our region, not Vietnam, China and Thailand, how HIV self-testing have been used, we can see that from the first study from the US here, when MSM and transgender women were offered that they can take one of their trusted friends to come to learn about HIV self-testing, that really helped make the perception of HIV self-testing to be less stressful. And then in Kenya, HIV self-test kit distributed to young women actually can increase testing among their male partners. And in France, where HIV self-test kit is available in the pharmacy, the survey among French pharmacists, however, actually identified certain challenges in some uncomfortable situations where pharmacists doesn't have a consistent implementation of how self-test kit should be displayed in the pharmacy, and then how a face-to-face consultation between the pharmacist and the client should happen. So it's not that easy that you can say that I can use an example from Thailand that we just the government may just think very in a very simple way that having self-test kit available in the pharmacy would just solve all the problem regarding access to HIV self-test kit, for example. And then in Africa, having HIV self-test kit available in the community actually increased HIV testing uptake with around 60% to 65% successful rate of linkage to care, which is not different from those not using self-testing. And then lastly, around self-testing. In Malawi, they have this facility-based HIV self-testing in which, although like you may imagine self-testing to be something in your own privacy, but by offering HIV self-test to patients in the outpatient setting, it can actually increase the uptake of HIV testing compared to provider-initiated counseling and testing with comparable HIV-positive testing yield. So this could be something in more applicable in a generalized epidemic setting. Then we have heard about this community-based thing, lay provider testing things. So let me take you into a little more depth into how we can really use key populations health services model to improve or enhance our HIV cascade. When we talk about community-based or community-led service, we usually think about the conventional roles that key populations or communities can do, which usually will just involve how peer can reach and then can recruit their friends into the service. But by saying key population-led health services, the meaning is broader than just having peer reaching and recruiting their friends into the service. I will start with an example from Malaysia, which is the setting where non-binary gender and sex acts are crime. So Malaysia has confirmed that it is feasible in that setting to actually use peer to do case management and do sensitivity training for healthcare providers, and that they can get half of those reach to have testing with high HIV positive yield at 9%, and they have been successful in reaching and getting key populations who are non-conventional key populations in Malaysia, so those who are not people who inject drugs into HIV programs. And then in Vietnam, where we have heard a lot about the key population lay provider providing HIV testing, I think this is the best example for many countries in our region. What we have seen is that among those clients who come for HIV testing by KP lab provider, 67% or two-thirds were first-time tester, and they have done a very good work in linking people who tested positive into treatment. But what is more impressive is that Vietnam just started this pilot in October 2016, and in less than 2 years, they have get this the Ministry of Health approval for National HIV Community Testing Guidelines in April 2018. So things has moved very, very quickly in contrast to Thailand. So I have to say that we are still struggling. We're talking to the Ministry of Public Health, we're talking to professional institutions, doctors, nurses, medical technologists, pharmacists, to allow services provided by trained KP lab providers to be accepted at the national level. And then I would like to touch a little bit on the good things about Thailand. We have this Tangerine Clinic established in 2017, and it is the first clinic where we provided the integrated hormone services and the sexual health services all together in one setting. And the data presented at AIDS 2018 showed that once you get transgender women into the care and you offer these hormone-related services to transgender women, you can actually retain them better into care. So they came back more frequently for repeat HIV testing, for repeat syphilis testing, and also they gradually accept PrEP over time. So you can see that the PrEP uptake is doubled when transgender women accept hormone services as well. And then I now would like to move to ART initiation, and by starting with same day ART initiation first before I talk about rapid ART initiation. So by talking about same day ART initiation, I'd like to start with Uganda, because the model there is quite interesting. They have lay testers who go out to the community. Community here is at home, in the workplace, to provide HIV testing and provide point of care, CD4 testing, point of care creatinine testing, point of care pregnancy testing. And once this lay tester identifies someone who is HIV positive, then they bring that person to nurse who is in the community ready to start ART on that same day. So by doing this, they have been successful in starting ART to 80% of the people who are eligible. Okay, so that's the community-based same-day ART model. And then in Thailand, this is where I work, the Thai Red Cross AIDS Research Center. We have the Thai Red Cross Anonymous Clinic, which is the largest HIV testing center in the region so far, serving around more than 40,000 people each year, serving clients coming in for HIV testing. And by starting this same day ART initiation hub model, we have been successful in starting people, in starting more than 2,000 people over just a year on ART, mostly on the same day of their HIV diagnosis, HIV diagnosis made, and then almost 100%, the exact number is 97%, started ART within 7 days. Okay. I just would like to go a little bit more into details of this same day ART initiation hub. I would like to stress that we are hub. We are not the long-term ART site. We're not hospital. We're just HIV testing site. And we do not intend to transform ourselves to be an ART, long-term ART facilities. So the model here is that anyone coming into our clinic having their HIV screening test, the first test, become reactive, we will then assess for their readiness to start ART while we are taking their second blood samples for HIV confirmatory test, as well as some additional volume of blood, which is enough for CD4 testing and all other safety, baseline safety laboratory testing, and send them to chest X-ray to get chest X-ray. So within 1 to 2 hours, we will get the HIV confirmatory results back. And for anyone with confirmed HIV positive, you also have the chest X-ray results coming back. And without any other lab results available, our doctors will do physical examination to rule out tuberculosis. So physical exam plus the history taking and the results from chest X-ray rule out tuberculosis. And then physical exam to rule out active cryptococcal meningitis. And once people are screened in, they will be able to get the first supply of their ART on that exact same day that they have their HIV diagnosis made. The first supply will be just only for 2 weeks. And during these 2 weeks, we have a clinic navigator assigned to each client. And the navigator will help support adherence, help manage all the common adverse events from ART initiation, and also help navigate the health insurance scheme. Because many people working in Bangkok, they are coming from many other provinces, and their registered ART hospitals are outside of Bangkok. And that's the main reason why the second 90 for Bangkok itself is only 56. So it's very low, just above half of all people living with HIV in Bangkok actually it had ART initiation. So in order to deal with that, we have our navigator to help with that health insurance scheme transition. So after 2 weeks, the clients come back, the doctors will then provide another no more than 2 months supply of ART, just to make sure that the client has adequate supply of ART during the transition to their long-term ART care. So this is the model that we call it the same-day ART initiation hub. And what you can see here is that by doing this, 80% of clients diagnosed at our clinic actually can have their first a prescription of ART on the first day of diagnosis, and then the rest will get that within the next 7 days. And we have seen that we have around 90% successful rate of referral to long-term care hospitals, because many hospitals get really scared that once they started ART for any client, they will have to take care of that client for the rest of their life and would not want that burden. We have demonstrated here that it is feasible that you just start ART and then refer them to long-term care if you have a good navigation system to help with healthcare insurance scheme transition. And retention rate at month 6 and month 3 and month 6 is above 90%. And among those who received the service, once we started this same-day ART initiation hub, they were almost 4 times more likely to start ART compared to when we did not have this service at our clinic. And they were also 2 times more likely to be virally suppressed compared to the historical control cohort. And now let's move to rapid ART. Many of you here probably are very familiar that WHO has recommended rapid ART initiation since 2016, meaning that we encourage everyone diagnosed with HIV to have ART started within 7 days after diagnosis or after being clinically assessed. And here, there are 2 examples of those countries who are doing rapid ART initiation. In Switzerland, they use a combination of peer who are people living with HIV who are on stable ART and who are having good adherence to reach out to patients who are out of care and bring them back to the system in the community using PLHIV peer in combination with nurse in the community. They've been successful in getting 96% of people be started on ERT. However, we can see that only 73% did so within 7 days. Okay, and in Botswana, when fast track ERT initiation has been implemented, we have seen that 63% successfully started ERT within 7 days, and then 73% within a month. So you can see here that the terminology of same day ERT or rapid ERT are playing with our minds here. You know, once you aim at having rapid ERT initiation, you feel that you can linger around for a few days because it will still be within 7 days to start ERT. But if you aim for same day ERT, the enthusiasm, the energy, the excitement for you and probably that needs to be for the whole team at your clinics or hospitals as well, will be totally different. You want to start someone on ERT on that same day, and you allow things to happen until 7 days. It's not like you can. You want everything to be able to complete within 7 days. It's a different feeling. So I'll come back to that later on. And then just these two slides for sustainability, because we know that there's been like inconsistent messages around how long external funding will be here in the region. I just would like to use an example from Brazil, where there are 500,000 people on ERT in the country with 100% government funding. And when the country plan to change their first-line regimen from an NNRTI-based to integrated inhibitor-based regimen, they aim to do that with the condition that there must not be significant increase in the budget. And many countries, by hearing that, would say that it's impossible that you are now changing to integrase inhibitor without increase in the annual budget. But Brazil successfully did that, and you can see the dark blue bars here. This is the total amount of money spent for ERT in 2016 before the changing of the first line regimen, and this is the amount of spending which. It's not that different from 2016 after integrase inhibitor has been integrated into as their first line regimen. And they did this through two main strategies. Number one is countries' price negotiation to the bidding processes. So the government sent a very clear message that we will only have one integrase inhibitor in the country. So rotegravir, dolutegravir, you will have to compete with each other to get to the lowest price. And then to also reorganize the drug portfolio in the guidelines, because many countries still keep those medications which are rarely used in their guidelines and their procurement system. So this is one way of countries doing domestic funding for their treatment program. And then in Vietnam, we have heard about how quickly the government moved into providing endorsement to HIV testing by lab providers. Here's another example of sustainable financing for treatment facilities, as we can see a dramatic increase in proportion of ART treatment facilities which have funding transitioned from donor funded system into a domestic public health funded system. And then now to PrEP, which is the last part of the talk here. I will be presenting to you several models of how PrEP could be implemented. And I believe that probably Heather Marie may have been talking about this already. But these are all those studies that were presented at AIDS 2016. I started with the first model in Thailand, where we now have around 5,000 to 6,000 people on PrEP, which translates into only like 4 to 5% of PrEP target. Okay, and then half of those people using PrEP in Thailand have been accessing PrEP through this key population-led PrEP model. And you may be familiar with this key model that I presented early on, but this is just to show you that the PrEP dispensing by lay providers, actually the expansion of the key population-led health services. We build on the existing capacities of lay providers who are members of MSM and transgender women communities who can provide counseling, provide HIV testing already into and build that capacity into someone who can also dispense PrEP